So everybody, the vacation fun is continuing and we're going to be doing a cooking episode for the first time in a little while. Today's menu is going to be chicken quesadillas for a little Mexican cuisine and maybe some pork burgers for good measure. All this and more on the Wandering Grill edition of the Wandering Ukie Cheese Cafe. Stay tuned. Saint-Laurent Boulevard. I feel like that every time I'm out on a Sunday, I'm always drawn back to the street just because normally under most circumstances, it's my way of kind of relaxing, getting some exercise and checking the sights and sounds before I have to go back to work. But luckily enough, I still have an extra week off as I'm recording this. So this is just going to be a nice, enjoy the sights and sounds without having to think about going to the office again. Just enjoy a good coffee and just look around. So, welcome to another edition of the Wandering Ukie Cheese Cafe. And I know I spent this week doing a few episodes on some random places like within the Southwest and along, Outremont when I did the smoked meat episode. But I realized that looking at my past videos, it's been a good 2 months since I actually recorded a cooking slash grilling episode. And because today's is really nice and I got some quick inspiration, I felt like I needed to rectify that. So, my goal is one of my favorite stops along the way, Jean Talon Market. And normally, most people would probably drive there, take the subway or the bus. Me, doing my usual, walking from downtown, up the street, to the market, and I'm gonna get some of my gear for cooking. But before we continue the walk, let me just suggest one more thing. Hit that subscribe button below and put the notification bell to on. That way, if I get a new video ready or get a pop-up, it's ready to view. Oh, and give me a thumbs up, please. That'll promote the channel. Marché Trenco. I feel like I've seen this a number of times, and I have an uncle mentioned earlier in the week that he's looking for a particular blend of French coffee. And given I am on the Plateau Montréal, which is considered like a little France, maybe there's a shot I could find a brand or something very similar for him. And on that same note, I will need something to give myself a bit of energy. So I think I'm gonna check it out. Got myself a nice Americano there. I should have thought about getting it iced, but it is what it is. May as well just enjoy it. So I did take a look at some of the coffee grains there, and it seemed like there were three brands, their house brand, and two other ones I don't really remember offhand. But luckily I took a photo of it so I could send it to my uncle and see maybe if that's the one he's referring to. At least given the fact I'm exploring the city all the time, it's a good way to kind of find new spots like I always do, and for my family, retrace old memories or find some oddities around here. I guess that's an appropriate one. Made my way into Little Italy within Rosemont La Petite Patrie. So one benefit of my aunt being retired is that she's able to do a lot of research or find some fun things. Sometimes it's like deals at grocery stores and tells me what's on sale. And other times it's like events that might be happening within the city that she thinks I could check out for fun or possibly to record and document on my vlog. So right there now, within Little Italy is Italfest, which is like their annual Italian festival, and she said that it was worth checking out to maybe document it. Now, I'm not sure if I'm going to be sticking around too long, because I do want to get home and grill, but apparently it's lasting until August 20th, so that means that if I want, I could come back another time, or worst case, say that I've been here. Pretty sweet Ferrari, I have to say. Seems like there's a couple of classic Italian cars here. I don't know all the marks offhand because I'm not an avid car connoisseur. I suppose if anyone is into them, that it would be worth checking out. Hey, still looks cool. Not that it's something I would drive. I'm a practical guy. I wouldn't have a vehicle to be sporty, to show off, or try to impress people. That's just me. Okay, so one of the other marks of cars was Fiat, so yeah, there is another one I remember. I also passed by a booth that seems to have Italian-style craft beer. I'm kind of familiar with a few of them around here, like Birra Barabiara Maison, which is actually a little further north of this street. Been there before. There's a couple of nice spots I should check out. Maybe if I do come back again next week or sometime, I'll figure out what else is around here. Okay, I'm getting back some flashbacks. I'm on Mozart Street, and I'm sure I already passed by Dante Street, if I haven't already been there. It's like, I always found it funny when I was coming around. Dante, like you go from the seven levels of hell to go into like one of the best, like a street named after one of the best composers on the planet. Okay, and if that does sound familiar to you, then I'm just gonna put a card in the top right corner for when I did my little walk around Little Italy last June. Already been over a year since I did that. So right behind me is the Birra microbrewery that's on Saint-Laurent within Little Italy. And yes, I did go there. I do recall I filmed a small quickie last year. and it was like a very nice sunny day, which turned into a very heavy rain day. So kind of got caught between a rock and a hard place, or in this case, caught in the middle of a storm. It did seem to calm up a little bit when I was finishing up, so it wasn't all that bad. And now, making my way to the market, so time for me to get the last of my stuff before I head on home and get some grilling done. So, just about got everything I needed to do my grilling for today, and I'm going to be wrapping up very shortly. I've said it before and I'll say it again, I love coming to this market. Great variety of stuff, so lively, and also brings back some good childhood memories. I used to come here with my parents and my bapcha, so it's always nice. And I feel like I'm always discovering something new when I come here. So, I think I just need a few more things. Today I wanted to grill some chicken quesadillas, and I realized that I kind of need to get some flour tortillas because it's kind of essential for that. So I'll probably gather that up and then get home, and then next thing you know, I'll be ready to char like I'm a very fine son of a gun. Oh, I guess that works too. Pretty awesome song also. Oh yes. Well, got home in one piece, got all my supplies done, and given the fact that I'm going to be doing some kind of a Mexican meal, figured I might as well go for a little tapas here as usual. I really love these olives. They're these organic Sicilian olives I like to get at Costco. If ever you're over there, you get a good amount of them for about 10 bucks a jar. It's really worth it. And sometimes if you're lucky, you're going to get a $2 rebate for that. Yeah, love this stuff. Like I keep saying, I got hooked on these things in Spain, because if you're to go to a bar, 9 times out of 10, that's the tapas they're going to be giving you for free. So I'm going to be starting the fire very soon, but obviously, because I'm going to be charring and it's really nice outside, I'm going to have to do it the proper way with a little bit of a brew. And I was trying to think, what can I do that I haven't really had before? I found a nice little shop around the market, so I didn't really go to Tzitfret or Peluso this time for my rations. It's something else that's also pretty awesome. It's Cat d'Origine, and this one is called the Forêt Kvek, which I guess is supposed to be like Nordic, Swedish, or something like that. It's a pretty nice one. Usually when I think Kvek IPAs, but this one's pretty interesting in the sense that it's kind of like a blonde, a bit hazy, unfiltered, and one of the things that it tastes like is spruce. So they have some essence of spruce in here, which is kind of, I guess, unique. Because when I think spruce, I think of spruce beer that you would get in stores. I remember my mom used to buy that or introduce me to that when I was a kid. And I think back then you might have had a couple of other brand names that sold that. But I feel like over time, the only way you can really get spruce beer is if you get the store brand, no name packets of soda there. Of course, it doesn't count the Marco brand that is that they brew over in the Fort Chambly, because that stuff is even better. The other one's like a typical soda, but this one that you get, the Marco brand, it does feel a little bit more natural in the sense that you might actually have residue of a spruce at the bottom. It's a 6%er. I'll find out what kind of a taste it has, and cheers to the beginning of week 2 of the vacation. Not bad at all. It's like a very subtle spruce taste. When I think spruce beer, I do kind of think of how it might taste like dishwashing liquid. So it's not a taste that's for everybody. Wash my mouth out with soap? Come on, I wasn't being vulgar. At least not this time. Well, I had to do a little bit of the bonus grilling here, not just for my quesadillas, but I'm also doing a little bit of pork burgers, or burgers as you could say, because my brother actually picked up some ground pork from the store today. It's one of those that came in one of those tubes that you could get for all sorts of ground beef. And then if you slice it up all within, I would say, an inch thick, that's a perfect amount to do a burger for yourself. And you might have remembered I did a burger recipe in the past. And in case you don't remember that, I'm putting a card in the top right corner for you to click on that too. My burger recipe I used a while back was basically a meatloaf recipe. So you got your beef, breadcrumbs, egg, a Worcestershire sauce, and a whole bunch of stuff together. But depending on who you ask, the perfect burger is just going to be ground meat with a little bit of salt and pepper for good measure. So there is a way to do that. And if you're really adventurous, you can even ground up your own meat and then season it up yourself, and then you make your own burger. That's if you really want to have it fresh. But that's only if you're ambitious. Who knows if I'm gonna be that ambitious one day. So, those burgers are going to be almost done. It looked like we had a good dozen or so, give or take, on there, and that should be good enough to eat for the rest of the week. Or worst case, they're going to be frozen as well, so they're very succulent. And in terms of seasoning too, well, it's actually a friend of mine that gave me this thing. It's like a blend of some kind of Korean chili, salt, pepper, parsley. I have to ask her again what it is, because it was pretty awesome when I used it on pork tenderloin on the grill once. I like it. But then once those are done, I'm going to be getting to the chicken quesadillas. But I guess there's another more important thing to worry about. I'm out of fuel. So my spruce essence is actually out of the way. And luckily I have another one I could showcase, because I want to do another IPA, specifically to finish off IPA week. And what I have here is something from the Eto Brasserie, their Session IPA, and it's about 4.1%. I got it for a couple of reasons. One, found this at the market that was over at the Jean Talon area. Two, I look at the artwork on this thing, and it kind of makes me think of all the graffiti you find all across the city, or I guess you could call it street art. And two, actually three, started to lose track of how I could count. It's give me an idea for a place to check out, because I know these guys followed me on Instagram not too long ago, and from what I could tell, it says it's on Saint-Denis Street, but pretty far north of Saint-Denis. Oh, they even tell you which subway station to get off at. Jarry? Okay, that's Villeray. So that means that I gotta make my way into Villeray sometime to be able to explore and see what else is around the area. It's kind of like what I was saying about my trip for Lester's Deli. Boreal, that brewery is originally from Blainville, but there's a new brewery that's, or a location, in Villeray 2 on Jean Talon. So I'm getting a few ideas to explore around there, because except for maybe Jarry Street a long time ago, and most likely Jarry Park, I haven't really done visits in Villeray, so it might be worth checking out. If I can explore Outremont, I could do the same thing for that. And so, cheers to the next round. Ooh, it's very nice. It's like a very citrusy flavor that I've noticed with these session IPAs. And when it's New England, that means it's even more pronounced citrus. So the pork burgers are all set to go, so that means I can move on to the next step of my grilling, the chicken quesadillas. So first thing you're going to need to do is get yourself a little bit of a spice mix all put together, and you don't really need to have anything too crazy here. I didn't have a chance to do this on camera, but just take my word for it. It's half a teaspoon each of dried oregano, chili pepper, and cumin. I'm kind of grateful I found this recipe too, because cumin is not a spice I use very often in my cooking, and sometimes I have to struggle to think, what am I going to put this in? How am I going to dress it up? And I'm not talking about dressing up like you're Madonna. That's a whole different ballgame. So once you have that, you just keep it aside, and then what you would do is you would need to get like a good 1 pound of chicken. So I had to get 2 packs of this. One pack is about 280 grams, and then the other one is 292 grams. So combined, you're looking at somewhere around 500 grams. So you're looking at a little bit more than a pound of chicken. But for all intents and purposes, this is enough. So first thing I'm gonna do, probably a good idea if I did this on my own, is get my glove on, and then I'm gonna get the chicken laid out on the counter here. Take note too, that I put it with some plastic wrap, so that I try to put, like, keep the infections to a minimum. So I'm gonna be taking each chicken boob out. Yes, I said chicken boob, I don't care. Take one out, two, and then you're gonna do the same thing for the other ones. And don't worry, I know exactly what I'm doing with this. I know how to work with meat. So once these are all here, I'm just gonna keep the empty packages away, and I'll clean that up afterwards. Next, apparently you need like a good tablespoon of olive oil. Frankly, I don't feel like measuring it, so what I'm gonna do instead is I'm just gonna dab this on a little bit and then give it a good massage. So I'll do it just like that. And because it's all greased up on my fingers, that means I can get to the bottom for maximum penetration. Just like so. And you're doing two things with this. One, the oil is gonna get it all heated up, so that means you're gonna get it to char properly. And two, the oil is gonna have something that you can use to coat each piece of meat. So I'll just take my clean hand and then just do a little dab and sprinkle of the spice mix. Just like so. And you don't have to worry about being stingy. You could be as liberal with this as you want. There. Okay, I'm gonna need a little bit more. And then what I'll do is I'll just pat it down So I have a nice coating. And if I feel like I need a little bit more spice, then I can always whip up another batch afterwards. There, so this is gonna look good. So the next step is I'm just gonna open this up and then get my chicken right on the grill. And I'm gonna be doing it spice side down. And yep, you're gonna notice that there's some pork on here as well, because I'm actually doing a little bit of pork brochettes for my brother too. So yeah, it's gonna be like a little bit of a grilling extravaganza for all of us. Okay, this is actually stuck on a little bit more than I expected. All right, so here we go. And worst case scenario, I'll just flip this around, then we'll be okay. Actually, get the glove off, get the bowl here, and I'll just do a little dab. Just like basically doing a dash of this onto each breast. Just like so. There. So I'm gonna close it back. And then I'm gonna need to cook this to an internal temperature of around, I would say 160 degrees Fahrenheit, give or take, because my brochettes have to be the exact same thing too. Pork and chicken, you don't want to fuck around with. And I suppose you're wondering what's up with the setup with the chicken breast and the second fire. Well, it's actually because I haven't really done a barbecue to this extent or like this period. And it seemed like all the heat that we had got put to use on the pork burgers. So I actually had to do a second round of fire to be able to get this thing started. I never actually ran out before, but you know, it's the first time for everything. But the truth be told, it's not like I'm in a kind of hurry, because it's not like Sunday normally where I have to rush and then think about going back to work, making sure I'm well rested. I still got the rest of the week off, and it's a nice day. As far as I can tell, it's the only nice day that's gonna be taking place this week. Because I'm seeing chance of rain, chance of thunder showers, chance of hail the size of canned hams. Oh wait, no, canned hams, that's like David Letterman trying to be a meteorologist. Okay, look up David Letterman in the 80s and you'll see exactly what I'm talking about. But the point is, it's a nice day. Sunday could just relax, and then when my meal is done, it's done. I don't have to worry about anything. That's what vacation is all about. It's been cooking for a good long time, so let's have a look at this. Oh yes. So as you can see, chicken breast starting to cook well. Now they got the fire all started again. So it means I can heat these aside on a plate. So if ever you're charring any meats, one thing that to remember is you could always go with the thickest piece, put a meat thermometer in there, and then measure to see if it's at the ideal internal temperature. Most meats are gonna be at around, let's say 160 degrees Fahrenheit. Other ones, like 145 is what you could get away with if you're working with pork tenderloin. We did have one here, but when I was doing the pork beforehand, it seemed like it was having some kind of a panic attack or spastic attack of sorts, so it became kind of useless. But another trick you could remember is with the juices. If your juices are a bit pink, they're still raw and they need to cook a little bit longer. But if they're running clear, then you're good to go, and it means it's well cooked on the inside. If ever you're not sure too, you can always give some things a slice. Steak, you don't have to worry about it. This chicken breast, I could even slice if I really wanted to, simply because I am gonna be slicing these up in my quesadillas. But there's another few steps we need to do before we can get to that. So next thing we need to do is get a few bell peppers all put together on the grill. Now the recipe that I found online says you need to use a skewer for the chicken, for the peppers and all that, but because it's nice weather, I feel like barbecuing, so that's what I'm gonna do. I got a red pepper and a orange pepper as opposed to a green pepper, because other colored peppers are gonna be a little sweeter, whereas a green pepper might be a little bit more bitter and sour, so might not be for everyone. And the next thing I'm gonna do is get a little bit of olive oil. And then the idea here is I'm just gonna sprinkle a little bit of this and then let it cook and soften up for about 5 minutes. Oh, let's get some seeds in there too. So then once I'm done with that, then we could basically start putting together the final pièce de résistance, which is gonna be your quesadilla. So chicken quesadilla, it's like one of many types of quesadilla dishes you can do, but the reason it's called a quesadilla is just because it involves a key ingredient, that being cheese. Yep, I am running a cheese cafe after all, so I feel like a cheese dish just feels extra appropriate for today. That comes from the Spanish word queso, which is Spanish for cheese. And that you can find a lot in some parts of Spain. And in fact, if you're going to like tapas bars, there's a good chance you might get some cheese drenched in olive oil. That was like one of my other favorite tapas I got when I was doing my run around Cava Baja. I thought that was pretty nice. Okay, just be generous with this. Soften it up. I might need to do a flipping on this for like, maybe after a few minutes. There, so just like that, a few minutes, flip it, and then once it's softened, we'll get it up, and then we'll be able to do our final steps to get the quesadilla at last. Well, I've got some peppers all sliced up, chicken's all sliced up too, so we're getting to the final steps of this. So there's a few key ingredients you need to be able to make this a proper quesadilla. So normally you would need like Monterey Jack cheese to do this, but I had trouble finding the stores I was looking at, so I just ended up with a Tex-Mex blend. So this thing was like a blend of Monterey Jack with jalapenos, a bit of cheddar, and what they call pizza mozzarella. I was talking to my sister about this and she said, pizza mozzarella, other mozzarella. Oh no, it was actually my brother too. You have mozzarella in general, but there's also pizza mozzarella, which is rubbery, which is made specifically for pizzas. So this thing is gonna get the job done. And I also got another cheese for myself. Shredded old cheddar. Yep, if I'm gonna be the type of guy that spews aged cheddar, I may as well have the appropriate cheese for that. So just opening up these bags so that I could dispense of the cheese. So this recipe, you're gonna need about four quesadillas, and you'll need maybe a cup each of each cheese. But the truth is there's no such thing as too much cheese here. But then the first thing I'm gonna need to do is also get my tortillas, because you kinda need your flour tortillas for this to be able to make a quesadilla. Normally you could put this in the skewer and then kinda put it together, but you know, I have the barbecue here, it's still kinda hot. I'm gonna take advantage. So, I'm probably going overboard here, but have one large tortilla. Then what you're gonna do while this is here is you're just gonna dab it with a bit of Tex-Mex. So I'm just gonna be generous with this. Don't worry if you're too much or too little, because it will all spread out. Tex-Mex, aged cheddar. Yep, so the essence of me is being included into this dish. Beautiful. Yeah. A little bit more for good measure. Then I pre-slice a few peppers so I can add that in as well. So red here, orange here, and then lastly, is going to be a little bit of, let's say, chicken thrown in for good measure. Okay, a few strands here, perfect. So then once you do that, all you need to do is fold it in half like so, like this, oop. And then let the cheese melt, and then you just have to flip it around after a few minutes, and then you're good to go. If you want any other ingredients, you could also use copious amounts of onion or even like sliced avocado. Thing is that I'm kind of running out of time because I'm kind of working with the daylight and I'm getting kind of hungry as fuck. I do want to eat eventually too. But at least you do that. And then after 3 minutes, you just give it a flip and then you're ready to serve it. So it's going to be awesome. Your telltale sign? Easy enough. Your chicken's cooked, pepper's cooked, so you really just got to make sure that your cheese is melted enough before you flip it. All right, so this took a little longer than I expected to, but I feel like it's gonna be well worth it. So once again, as a recap, I've got a chicken quesadilla here and tortilla with some peppers, lots of cheese. So it's like maybe three, maybe four cheeses. All depends if your aged cheddar is gonna be different from your standard issue cheddar. But I had to go for something else also. Basically, I had to go for the works. At the place I tried a chicken quesadilla recently, they served it with tortilla chips. And I felt like I have to have that on the side too. And of course, a little bit of sour cream. Because from what I've read, a lot of stuff like tacos, burritos, quesadillas, you get sour cream on the side. And then you don't have to go so crazy about it. Just get yourself a no-name brand and then you're good to go with that. And remember too, I'm Ukrainian, so I'm used to sour cream. If you're making your pierogies or vareniki or however you like to call them, sour cream is the traditional dip. And just in case you want to know, for Christmas 2022, I have the episode right on the top right corner to click on. You're going to see that I did some pierogies from start to finish, and that was bloody amazing. Oh. Okay, so I just realized something. Here I am setting up my meal, but I forgot to get a fork. Fuck it. So I'm just gonna give this a shot. So fire went out. I forgot a fork. What's next? Actually, don't answer that question because I'd rather not know. I just wanna see what this thing is like, to taste it, and then eventually I'll get a fork. Mm-hmm. Just the right amount of cheese for me. Marvelous. So I think I'm gonna really enjoy this. And just to wrap things up, this was a hell of a grilling episode that was done. Pork burgers that were done, attempted brochettes that, yeah, in case you were wondering, they end up in the oven because I had to restart the heat. Chicken quesadillas with some tortillas. It was amazing, with a nice little wander and check out the Jean Talon Market as usual. So everyone, thanks for watching this latest edition of the Wander Ukie Cheese Cafe. And once again, if you like what you see, come on, bring the card. Much better. So if you like what you see, click that subscribe button below and give me a thumbs up if you enjoy my wanders, my cooking, my storytelling, and all my exploration around here. And if you have any ideas for a future episode I could do, like something I could try to cook at home, a bar I can check out around Montreal, leave it in the comment section and I'll see what I could do. Till then, take care everyone, and I'll see you next time. Love these chips. Was the son of a preacher man, the only boy who could ever teach me. Was the son of a preacher man, you see, he was.